Welcome back, fellow Earthlings. My name is Rogan, and you are watching the Mysterious Stoner in a Bowler. I am a little excited for today because in this particular series, if you're joining us for the first time, we talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly in the Bible. It's not as holy as you might think it is, but it does have some good things to take away from it every now and again. And today is the first day, well, the first episode, where we actually are going to have something good come out of the Bible that we can learn today. How could it be so terrible up to this point? Well, you'll have to watch my previous episodes to find out, if you haven't. But we have a bit of a story to dive into, so I'm not even going to tell you what happened at the end of the last episode or anything. We're just going to dive straight in right after I have a smoke. It's the first time talking about something good out of the Bible that we're actually going to be learning, and so why not have some straight up flower? This is honestly my favorite way of smoking weed. And I really love this bong because, as you can see, it is not made of glass like most bongs are made of. This is made of silicone. And you can wash it in a dishwasher. Except I do not own a dishwasher, so it's not as clean as it looks, but still functions quite well. I wish I could do other tricks aside from smoke rings, but that's all I can do. And that is plenty enough for now. Alright, so Jacob, the younger brother who cheated his older brother Esau, is returning, well, in the relative direction of home, his country where his father is living and everything. And I'm not good with the geography, but apparently where Esau lives is on the way, and Jacob decides to go see his brother. Remember, Esau wanted to kill Jacob last time Jacob was with Esau. The only reason Esau didn't kill Jacob right away, he was actually waiting. Not sure how they got the information, but according to the Bible, Esau was waiting until his father had died, because he was very close to dying, and or so they thought. And he was going to wait till the days of mourning for his father were over. There's days of mourning back then that they do after funerals and such. And he was going to wait for that time to be over, and then he was going to kill Jacob. But somehow, mother found that out, or at least knew that Esau was planning to kill Jacob at some point, and she had Jacob run away. And now Jacob is returning, and you know, I don't know if how Jacob felt for cheating his brother out of his blessing. He also took his birthright. That was some strange shit going on there. Very shady. But so Jacob and Esau have never really been on good terms. And now, after leaving Esau on a bad note, no word of apologies made or anything, or if Jacob felt bad about it. But it seems now Jacob is finally trying to make amends, so it seems. And so he sends messengers to Esau. And he commanded them. This is in chapter 32, if anyone's interested in following along. I'm using the King James Version because that's what I was raised on, even though it may not be the technically most correct version of the Bible. But in verse 4, he tells his servants to say, "Thus shall ye speak unto my lord Esau. Thy servant Jacob saith thus, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed there until now. And I have oxen and asses, donkeys, flocks and men servants and women servants. And I have sent to tell my lord that I may find grace in thy sight." And that's it. That's all he wrote. I don't know why he didn't say, "Oh, and sorry about cheating you out of your blessing and your birthright." I don't know. The Bible has a weird way of things, and people talked very differently back then. So maybe an apology was heavily insinuated by what is said here. I don't know. This is just what's literally written here. That is supposedly the infallible, perfect word of God. And the messengers returned to Jacob. And they said, We came to thy brother Esau, and also he cometh to meet thee, and 400 men with him. Oh. 400 men. That's a lot. Jacob, you know, Jacob doesn't have an army, just so you know. It's just him. He has two wives and about 13 children, and between all of them, including two maidservants that his wives made them fuck. Yes, that's in the Bible, children. I forgot to mention, this is a primarily mature channel. Yes, channel. I was going to say series, but the entire channel is for mature audiences. And plus, it's the Bible. It's a very it should be rated R, really, for what goes on in this book. But, and Jacob has tons of flocks and he, okay, he's rich, all right? He's got a ton of cattle, but not really anything in the way of guards or a military. And Esau is on his way with 400 guys. I don't know what Esau was thinking with bringing 400 men with him, especially in the response to Jacob's message. And there's no message given in return to Jacob. It seems as though Jacob has no idea what is going on in Esau's head. The servants just somehow know that Esau is coming, but Esau has no word for him. Anyways, Jacob naturally panics. 400 men versus a bunch of women and children and a shit ton of flocks with just enough guys to maybe protect them from bandits, but not to take on 400 men. I mean, 100 is like a small army. 400, that's a good size. That's a really good size. You don't walk around with 400 men just anywhere. Especially back then. So Jacob was greatly afraid. and distressed. And so he divided the people that was within the flocks, the herds, the camels, into two bands, and said, if Esau come to the one company and smite it, then the other company which is left shall escape. So, trying to give at least 50% of all that he has a chance at survival. And then Jacob prays to God for deliverance, because he's scared, and he has this elaborate prayer that he makes, reminding God of all the promises God made to him and everything. God doesn't say anything back, just so you know. This prayer of Jacob just happens to be here. And then Jacob gets a very, very wise idea. He decides to send a present to Esau. I don't know why he didn't think to do this in the first place. Maybe Esau wouldn't have shown up with, or wouldn't have decided to leave with 400 guys if Jacob had thought of this before. And it's, you know, it's only fair considering that Jacob cheated Esau out of a birthright and very important blessing. I'd say he owes Esau a bit more than the gift, and he should have had it starting out, but at least he's thought of it. And this is really good. This is really good. He's trying to reunite with Esau, and he has, thankfully, thought up the idea to have a peace offering. Always a good idea to bring a peace offering when trying to reunite with someone whom you've hurt. Excellent idea. Well done, Bible. 1 point for the Bible against all the other negative marks that we've had so far. But Jacob gets his present together, and it's a pretty nice present too. Cattle were the currency of, well, they were the currency before the currency existed. If you had tons of cattle, you were rich. And so he decides to send 200 she-goats. And 20 he-goats, 200 ewes, and 20 rams. These are very odd number choices, but I take it it's for a reason. Maybe it has something to do with breeding, I don't know. 30 milk camels with their colts, 40 kine, I'm not sure what those are. Some sort of cattle, I'm not quite sure. And 10 bulls and 20 she-asses, donkeys, and 10 foals. So yeah, that's a shit ton of livestock right there. That would be a lot for any person to own today. Like you could make some, you could, like, that's enough to start your own farm and ranch or whatever you want to do with it. That could make a man rich very easily if he knew what to do with it. So yeah, that was Jacob's present that he made, and he sends it off, and he sets them up in layers, sending them towards the direction in which Esau is coming, so that Esau comes to his present in layers. And it's rather interesting. Jacob tells his servants, to walk ahead of him separately with all these, with this gift, all, you know, all categorized and everything. And he says, as Esau passes by, you make sure to tell him, if he asks, you know, whose these all belong to, that you let him know it's mine. You make sure he knows it's my gift to him. That all he sees here are for him. I guess so that Esau's just has feels like he's been given tons of presents as he has come in. I mean that it's a lot. And but there's still Esau is still a ways away from Jacob. And then this interesting little event occurs that we'll discuss briefly because it well. As briefly as I can, because we want to get back to the main story. But this is so. This is the next thing that happens in the story. Even though it's not really connected to Esau or anything, this is when it happens. So Jacob is apparently out walking by himself, and it says, "And Jacob was left alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day." That's what it says. One second Jacob is alone, and the next he's wrestling with a random male stranger all night until dawn, apparently. And what kind of wrestling this is, we have no idea. We don't... maybe the scholars can define it a bit better. Maybe it was an actual fist fight or something. I don't know. I don't think it makes that much of a difference, but they're wrestling. And I believe this is referring to the stranger. It says, "And when he saw that he prevailed not against him," that is, when this stranger saw that he wasn't winning against Jacob. Apparently Jacob's good at wrestling now. No history of that anywhere. Whatever. So the stranger is having a hard time winning, and says, "And he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him." That sounds very painful. If he put him out of joint or something, but later on it says that when he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh in the sinew that shrank. That's how it states it here. It makes it sound like the stranger did something magical, possibly, like touched him and made something in Jacob's body shrink that naturally wouldn't have. But obviously we'll never know the truth of what actually happened, because this situation may not have even happened. Jacob may have stumble and hurt himself. He's lied before plenty of times, and he's quite good with his words. So who's to say this really happened? But we're going with what's written here and what's written supposedly what happened. And so whoever this stranger was, he did this thing to Jacob, hurt him pretty badly. But Jacob, he wouldn't let go of this guy. He had him, I guess he got him in some sort of a lock and wouldn't let him go. And this stranger said, "Let me go, for the day is here. Like, it's morning. Can we stop this now? I'm ready to go home." And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. I don't know if this was a traditional thing as part of wrestling people or something. I don't know what Jacob had on his mind. I don't know why he wants to get blessed by this random stranger who he's been wrestling with all night. Maybe they were actually fucking. Who knows? I don't know. He could have completely lied in. And Jacob's injury was a sex injury, maybe. It was located, you know, on his thigh. In the sinew that shrank. Okay, maybe he, like, really sprained something getting his ass fucked or fucking this stranger. I don't know. Wrestling all night till the morning. That's plenty of time for multiple rounds. I mean, they had to rest sometime, right? I mean, come on. Really? Anyways, they wrestled. And Jacob had them in the headlock. Okay. And said, I won't let you go until you bless me. Whatever the fuck that means. To a guy who's wrestling a complete stranger. And he said, and the stranger said to him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. Yes, that Israel. But for as a prince hast thou power with God, and with men hast prevailed. Interesting. But yes, this is where the name of the country of Israel comes from. This guy who likes to cheat people. You can go to the stories that took place before this with Jacob, and you can see what kind of person he was. And you can judge for yourself if he was a good guy or not. If he seemed like someone whom you would trust and do business with. Go through my series, you'll see. Abraham was a scammer, and his son tried to be a scammer, wasn't as good at it, but he tried. And Jacob was quite a successful scammer. And then he has this random encounter with a stranger, and he comes back injured and calling himself Israel because a random stranger told him. I believe later on in the Bible, it's said that it's assumed that it was God, or even Jesus Christ himself, that Jacob wrestled with. I think somewhere it says something that Jacob wrestled with God or something like that later on. Obviously not here, that's not how it words it here, but later on in the Bible it refers to this passage, I believe. I'm pretty sure about that. But it is assumed, either way, it is assumed by most people that it's saying that God wrestled with Jacob, and Jacob won against God. And God's way of trying to get out of it was to hurt Jacob, which sounds like, I mean, if this were a, like, is that a legal wrestling move in any, like if this is friendly competition, that's not a friendly move, that's a cheat move, which, considering the way Jehovah is, that actually makes a lot of sense now. Holy shit. Like the Tower of Babel. Holy. That was getting a little bit too out of hand for God. People were uniting a little bit too much, getting along too well. Touches them in the language nerve, and poof, they spread out, because all of a sudden, overnight, everyone has different languages. Because God didn't want humans uniting. And here, this stranger hurts Jacob, which may or may not have been against the rules of whatever wrestling game they were wrestling, if they weren't fucking, game they were playing. Like, that just doesn't seem fair. Oh, I'm not winning. Oh, I'm gonna fucking hurt you. That sounds a lot like Jehovah. That sounds a lot like a sore losing Jehovah to me. Yeah, sure. Maybe he really was an alien that could be physically overpowered and was afraid of humans uniting. Maybe. But Jacob comes back from that experience calling himself Israel, because he supposedly wrestled with God and won, and what was the thing about men? Oh yeah, and with men and has prevailed. A prince hast thou power with God and with men and hast prevailed. Or I think the other wording is, you have wrestled with God and with men and have prevailed. So now he's coming back, calling himself a prince now. Okay. Just claiming royalty out of the blue. Because God, or whoever this was. Oh yeah, Jacob did ask him what his name was. And he says, what is thy name? And, oh, sorry. Jacob asked him, And Jacob asked him and said, tell me, I pray thee, thy name. And he said, wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name? And he blessed him there. So yeah, Jacob got what he wanted, except he didn't find out this random stranger's name, which is supposedly why it's God. Well, the guy just can't be anonymous in scripture. He's got to be God. Why does he have to be God? Why? Just because he wouldn't give his name. He totally could have given his name. He could have been like, yeah, my name's Bob. Yeah, Bob. Well, it was Bob. Yeah, Jacob beat Bob in the wrestling match. Oh no, that doesn't sound very impressive. He wouldn't give his name. It must have been God he was wrestling. Yes. Couldn't possibly be a random stranger. No. It was a person who wouldn't give me his name that I beat in the wrestling match. It must have been God. Yeah, okay, whatever. So, in the morning, Jacob lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, oh, there's Esau on the horizon. And with him, 400 men. And so Jacob gathers his wits about him, and he goes out to meet Esau. And he's very humble towards Esau. He bows to Esau over and over again every time he steps closer to him. But Esau ran to meet him and embraced him. And they hugged and kissed and they cried. So Jacob and Esau have a wonderful reunion. And Esau gets to meet all of Jacob's family. And he actually doesn't want the gift from Jacob. But Jacob, like, really, 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 really insists that Esau take the gift. And everything is great. Everything is wonderful. The brothers are reunited, and they have to go their separate ways again, because they travel at a different pace from each other. The way Jacob talks to Esau a little bit further down. He seems like he might be a little bit intimidated by Esau and all his 400 men, but everything is fine between them. They are reunited and all is well between the brothers once more. Peace is made, the hatchet is buried, and brotherhood restored. And that is the end of the story. Quite the happy ending, I must say. And quite an excellent turn of events and wonderful display of maturity on all parties involved. Well, except for the stranger who wrestled with Jacob. He was a sore loser. Fuck that guy. Well, so what is the lesson we can learn from this overall story? Well, even though it doesn't outright say it, I wish it had, but it didn't. When you're in the wrong with someone, it's always good to apologize to someone. Because, I mean, you don't want to make enemies. It's just not, it is not wise. When you make enemies want things to, well, typically they do not want things to go well for you if they are a true enemy. And you don't need that in your life. You prefer your life to go without problems from others, if possible. Right? Jacob realized, I don't know when he realized it, but he realized he needed to make things right with Esau, or perhaps Esau would quite possibly come and kill him. So it was in Jacob's best interest to apologize to Esau. Now, hopefully you never piss off someone so much that they want to kill you. But if you do, I suggest trying to make amends as best you can, if possible. Some people, once you piss them off after a certain point, there is no reasoning with them. Unfortunately, that is a possibility that can happen with anyone. Everyone has their limitations. But typically, that's not something that's going to happen. Still, when you do something wrong, you want to make things right. You don't want to make an enemy out of a potential ally. And Jacob realized this. And he went to Esau. It's always better to apologize to the person you've wronged by going to them, instead of waiting for them to enact revenge, coming to you, and then apologize. Because they're kind of on the train. They're kind of on the revenge train, and that's a train that can be hard to get off once you're on it and rolling. So it's always wisest for you to do the approaching. And even though he didn't think of it first, to his credit, Jacob did decide to give Esau a gift. Obviously, you can't always give something to make up for what you've done. And I don't know how valuable the birthright and blessing was to Esau, but it pissed him off to want to kill Jacob. It seemed like the birthright and blessing were both extremely valuable to Esau. Hopefully, whatever Jacob gave to Esau was somewhere in the ballpark of what the birthright and blessing were worth to Esau. But that's a lot to want to kill someone over it. Pretty serious business. But props to Esau for forgiving Jacob. And even being willing to turn down the gift. He tried to turn down the gift from Jacob. He didn't need it. He didn't want it. Jacob was very insistent. It was good on his part that he did that. because, again, he didn't say that he apologized, but between insisting Esau giving the gift, bowing to him, and just showing great humility to him, and it seems that Jacob was genuinely sorry for what he did to Esau, genuinely apologetic. And Esau saw that. And that was enough for Esau. Esau didn't demand more of Jacob. He even denied the gift. He was so forgiving that he didn't want to take out anything from him at all. That's what a real mature adult does. I mean, he was able to see the genuineness in Jacob and let it all go. And that's great. I mean, I wish humans were more like that. It takes some strength to admit when you're wrong and to approach someone and apologize. But it is one of the greatest things you can do, not only for the person you offended, but for yourself. And that is where we will end this episode. Next week, we are going to have quite the adult level episode. Just warning you, this is one of those stories that is really fucked up. It's one of those stories that make you going to have to open the Bible and look it up for yourself because of how crazy it gets. Oh, yes, it involves Jacob. This is the very next thing that happens. It involves Jacob and his sons and the one daughter that he has. And I am not telling you anymore. You'll have to come back next week to find out. So if you have enjoyed this video, I hope you will leave a like, click the subscribe button if you haven't, share it with your friends. There is a challenge for you. You'll have to scroll through the videos to find it. It's specifically labeled. You can't miss it in the videos that I have. Challenge for you to try and figure out. Speaking of, I still need to create an update video specifically for that. I'll have to do that one of these coming up weeks. But another time, another place. We'll get to that eventually. Leave a like, subscribe, share. Stay safe, my friends, and until next week, farewell.